إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has made it possible for us to start another class today, inshallah, regarding our book, Al-Adabul, Mufrad.
The first issue is that for most of us, our copies of the book will start with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. It's not for all of us. Otherwise, for all of us, our book should be starting with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And I am sure we will have 10 many of the books, even the Quran. We have seen many of the books of our elite scholars start with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So this question will come to mind that why is it that our scholars The scholars have mentioned two main reasons. The main reason why our book starts with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Essentially, the first of it is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself started his book and Quran. If we go to the first chapter of the Quran, Surah Al-Fatiha, you see it starts with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So the scholars comment their books by saying Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has also started his book with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So they follow that Sunnah of Allah by starting his book with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. They will say Iqtida al-Kitabillahi by way of following the book of Allah. So they will start with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. This is the first reason, the first main reason why the scholars start their book with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. The second main reason why the scholars start their book or their book with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is because the Prophet himself, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, whenever he dictated a message to be written to those to whom he has written, alayhi salatu wa sallam, he started that dictation which was written down in letters to the people. Al-Imam Muhammad ibn Sulul has done a great job in this regard. He went ahead to compile the letters that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had dictated to be written to different peoples of the world. He compiled it in his book, Al-Imam Sa'idin, Kutubi Sayyid al-Mursaleen. Al-Imam Sa'idin, Kutubi Sayyid al-Mursaleen. By Al-Imam Muhammad ibn Sulul. If we go into this book, Al-Imam Sa'idin, we find that the entirety of the message is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wrote to people by way of inviting them to Islam, by way of teaching them the message, by way of guaranteeing them, like he did even to Talha ibn Ubaydillah. He wrote these letters and started them sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Those were as for him. Started by writing Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So the second main reason why our scholars have said this Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is by way of following Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who will dictate his writings to people to start with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. More so that the books the scholars have written are like messages to the rest of the Ummah, to the the Prophet who is now 70 verses and comments them with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started his message with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Our scholars too have started to comment that with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. The third reason for us now, the rest of us, when we write our works, the third reason for us to start with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is جرى عليه عمل العلماء جريان عمل العلماء. This is the third reason for us. Our scholar subject is Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So we have two reasons and one reason. The first reason is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started his book with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. The second reason is that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started his message with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And the third reason is that our scholars, rahimahumullah, right from the time, the earlier times when the books were compiled, they started their books with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. The Shaykh Ibrahim Abdurrauf, the Shaykh Imam Bukhari, started with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Both of Sunan al-Idari, both of Sunan al-Tirmidhi, both of Sahih Muslim. Al-Imam Muslim started his Muqaddima of his Sahih with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. We find all these books starting with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. The reason why we start with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Allah started his message with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam who writes his message starts with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And likewise, our ulama in the past in the history of Islam and in present, will comment their books and starting with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. The second point we like to discuss today is that most of the copies you will find of Al-Adabul Mufrad, for those of our brothers who have their copies in purely Arabic, you'll find Al-Adabul Mufrad by Al-Imam al-Bukhari, the prince of Darul Hadith in Cairo. Likewise, the prince of مكتبة الهدى المحمدي. مكتبة الهدى المحمدي. You will also find it. Likewise, the copy of Dr. Luqman Muhammad Luqman Salafi. You will also find this copy and the copy of Dar Ibn Kathir. We've mentioned about four copies now that I have. Many of the copies that you will find in Arabic. Many of the printed copies you will find entirely in Arabic. You will start with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And then they say, Babu Qawli Allah Ta'ala, wa wassayna al-insana biwalidayhi husna. And then they will say, Akhbarana Abu Nasr, Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn al-Hasan, and so on. This is what many of the copies will start with. أخبرنا أبو نصر أحمد بن محمد. And I think that's what you also find on the copy that our brothers have displayed on the screen. This statement, أخبرنا أبو نصر. Who is it that has made it? Is it Al-Imam al-Bukhari who made this statement, أخبرنا أبو نصر? Because you find that at the tail end of that isnad, you find Al-Imam al-Bukhari there, Haddathana Abu Abdullah Muhammad ibn Ismail. You find Al-Imam al-Bukhari that. You find Al-Imam al-Bukhari occurring towards the end of that isnad before the matn of the first hadith that was mentioned. I'm talking about hadith number one. It says, أخبرنا أبو نصر أحمد بن محمد ابن الحسن, and so on. الإمام, this Imam, his name is also popularly called as ابن النيازكي. ابن النيازكي رحمه الله. To find that there is a statement that says, أخبرنا أبو نصر ابن النيازكي. This statement, أخبرنا, it's not the statement of Al-Imam Bukhari, it is the statements of those who have written down this book, Al-Adabul Mufrad. They have written in the manuscripts, the copies they wrote down with their hands. In the past, our scholars, when they wrote a book, what they did was that they came out to read that book, to dictate that book to their students. So when they dictate the book to their students, the student writes down their own copies of the book. Each student produces his own copy. And then comes back to make a comparison within between the standard copy of the scholar, the teacher, in this case Al-Imam Al-Bukhari, and the student. Each student comes now to read from the copy of the teacher and then correct whatever requires correction from his own copy. This is the way our teachers, our scholars, since the past, they wrote down their book. Sometimes the scholar will write the book and give it to the students. And each student will make his copy and correct the copy as one at the same time. And sometimes they had master copy with them. They wrote with their hands. They wrote with their hands. Because even the Mufrad at the time used to be written with their hands. So they would write with their hands and dictate what they have written to their students. What are we doing? We are trying to explain that this statement that most of the Arabic prints we have of Al-Adab al-Mufrad Ahbarana Abu Nasr ibn al-Nayaziki, who then goes to say Rahimahullah that Ahbarana Abu al-Khayf, who then goes to say Haddathana Abu Abdullah Muhammad ibn Ismail ibn Ibrahim, then mentions Al-Imam al-Bukhari. We are trying to explain why is it there. This is the isnad of the book up to the person who documented it. This is Al-Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah. This book was written from him by Abu al-Khayr Ahmad ibn Muhammad. Abu al-Khayr Ahmad ibn Muhammad al-Kirmani. Al-Imam Abu al-Khayr Ahmad ibn Muhammad al-Kirmani wrote down Sahih al-Bukhari from Al-Imam al-Bukhari in Bukhara, the city of Al-Imam al-Bukhari. This statement itself is so clear when he said Haddathana. What it means is that after Al-Imam al-Bukhari wrote down Al-Adab al-Mufrad, he read it to them. He says Haddathana, meaning that Al-Imam al-Bukhari read Al-Adab al-Mufrad to Ras. He read it to Ras. So each student wrote down his copy and then came back to correct whatever possible errors from the copy, the standard copy of Al-Imam al-Bukhari. This is the way that our scholars write down their works. So Al-Imam Abu al-Khayf, would find it there, those of us with the copies in Arabic, you find that Abu al-Khayf Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn Jali al-Bukhari al-Kirmani al-Abuqat al-Uzzar wrote down this book from Al-Imam al-Bukhari, and he says Haddathana Abu Abdullah, and then he mentioned the name of Al-Imam al-Bukhari. Al-Imam al-Zahabi, in his book, Tarikh al-Islam, when he mentioned the biography of Al-Imam Abu al-Khayf, this Abu al-Khayf we are talking about, Al-Imam al-Zahabi, rahimahullah, he mentions in his book, Tarikh al-Islam, he says, Rawa kitab al-adab عن مؤلفه أبي عبد الله البخاري في بخارى. الإمام الذهبي in تاريخ الإسلام when he talked about أبو الخير أحمد بن محمد البخاري he says روى كتاب الأدب. This Imam Abu al-Khayr was the one who collected كتاب الأدب, that is our book الأدب المفرد, عن مؤلفه from his author أبي عبد الله البخاري في بخارى. He collected it from Al-Imam al-Bukhari, he wrote it down from him at Al-Bukhara. فَسَمِعَهُ مِنْهُ أَبُو نَصْرٍ. So Abu al-Khayr wrote down from Al-Imam al-Bukhari, Abu Nasr Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn al-Niyaziki. Ibn al-Niyaziki. In this copy of Darul Hadith that I'm reading from, it says Ibn al-Tabaziki, if an error. He is Ibn al-Niyaziki. So Al-Imam al-Zahabi says, رحمه الله, فَسَمِعَهُ مِنْهُ أَبُو نَصْرٍ. from Ahmad ibn Muhammad. Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn Niyadiki al-Bukhari. So Abu Nasr, not Abu Nasir. Abu Nasr ibn Niyadiki wrote it from Abu Faith. Ibn Niyadiki is also from Bukhara. He wrote down Al-Adabul Mufrad from Abu Faith, who wrote it from Al-Imam al-Bukhari. So Abu Nasr wrote from Abu Faith. We are reading from Al-Imam al-Zahabi in his book, Tariq al-Islam. He says, فَسَمِعَهُ مِنْهُ After talking about Abu al-Faith, he said, فَسَمِعَهُ مِنْهُ Abu Nafs. He said, Abu Nafs ibn al-Niyadiki wrote down Al-Adab al-Mufrad from Abu al-Faith. Abu Nafs Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn al-Niyadiki wrote it down. Al-Bukhari ibn al-Niyadiki is also from Bukhara. شيخ القاضي أبي العلاء شيخ القاضي أبي العلاء It means that Abu Nasr has a student whose name is Al-Qadi Abu العلاء So when we say أخبرنا we can ask the question The person who made this statement أخبرنا It was read to us This person أخبرنا This ضمير In this statement, this person who is telling us that he was, it was read to him, was Al-Imam Abu al-Ala Muhammad ibn Ali al-Was. His name is Abu al-Ala Muhammad ibn Ali al-Wasiti al-Qadi. He was a Qadi, rahimahullah. And it's from the pictures of Al-Imam al-Khatib al-Baghdadi. So this akhbarana, if we are asked, who made that statement? That statement, akhbarana Abu Nasr, was made by Al-Imam Abu al-Ala Muhammad ibn Ali ibn Ahmad al-Wafiti, the teacher of Al-Imam al-Khatib al-Baghdadi. This Imam Abu al-Ala al-Wafiti, the two isnads that I have seen from manuscripts of Al-Adab al-Mufrad, come to end with him, Abu al-Ala, that we have said, he was the one who said Akhbarana. Abu al-Ala, al-Wasifi, two different chains of record of this book, Al-Adab al-Mufrad, have come to end with Abu al-Ala al-Wasifi. So it means we have Abu al-Ala al-Wasifi recording Al-Adab al-Mufrad from Abu Nafs ibn al-Niyadiki, who was recording from Abu al-Khair al-Bukhari, who is recording from Al-Imam al-Bukhari himself, rahimahullah. Like I said, we have two isnads. The first isnad is the isnad of Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar al-Rahim. Ibn Hajar himself is 8th century scholar of Islam, 800 years. And Al-Imam al-Bukhari died in the half 256 after his death. So you would see between 700 years of Ibn Hajar and 256 of Al-Imam al-Bukhari, that's an isnad. That's an isnad from Ibn Hajar up to Al-Imam al-Bukhari. So now, we will read to us how the connection between, we have read to us the connection between Abu al-Ala and Al-Imam al-Bukhari. Abu al-Ala read Al-Adab al-Mufrad from Abu Nafs. Abu Nafs read from Al-Imam Abu al-Khair. Abu al-Khair read Al-Adab al-Mufrad from Al-Imam al-Bukhari. Okay, it remains from Abu al-Ala to Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar, 7th century. Between Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar and Al-Imam al-Qadi Abu al-Ala al-Wasifi. If we go to Al-Jawahir wa-Dura, fi tarjamati Shaykh al-Islam, Ibn Hajar by Al-Imam al-Sakhawi. Al-Imam al-Sakhawi is a student of Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar. Just like Ibn Qayyim was, rahimahullah, to Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah. That was how Al-Imam al-Sakhawi was to Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar. In fact, in the case of Al-Imam al-Sakhawi, his father, wherever he went to, when they were Egypt, he deliberately went to get a house near the house of Al-Hafiz. The father of Sakhawi went to get a house near Ibn Hajar so that his son, Al-Imam al-Sakhawi, would have an opportunity to
to do a class, to do classes with Al-Hafiz. But that they became so used to themselves. It was even reported that sometimes when Al-Imam Ibn Hajar rahimahullah wants to do a class and Al-Imam al-Sakhawi has not attended, he will stop the class and wait for Sakhawi to attend. If Al-Imam al-Sakhawi does not come, the class may not hold. Rahimahullah. They became so close. Al-Imam al-Sakhawi became the reporter of the knowledge of Al-Hafiz Ibn Hajar. And one of the things that he has reported from Ibn Hajar rahimahullah is our book called Fath al-Bari, which was still remains one of the best, if not the best, shot of Sahih al-Bukhari. So Al-Imam al-Sakhawi, after his teacher passed away, or before he passed away, he wrote a biography of his teacher Al-Hafiz that he had lived it for 46 years. He was happy. There are other issues regarding Ibn Hajar and Al-Imam al-Sakhawi. But the point here is, Al-Imam al-Sakhawi wrote down the isnad of Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar for Al-Adabul Mufrad. How did Al-Imam Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar read Al-Adabul Mufrad? Al-Imam Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar read Al-Adabul Mufrad and wrote it down, got his own copy of Al-Adabul Mufrad from Al-Imam Abu Bakr ibn Abdul Aziz ibn Al-Badr. This Imam Abu Bakr, who is from whom Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar wrote down his copy of Al-Adab al-Mufrad, from whom he read his copy of Al-Adab al-Mufrad, is the grandchild of Al-Imam Badruddin ibn Jamah. Badruddin ibn Jamah. Many of us, we know the book, Tazkirat al-Sami' wal-Mutakallim. Fi adabi talib al-ilm. في آداب العالم والمتعلم. فالإمام بدر الدين ابن بدر الدين ابن جماعة is a very very well known scholar of Islam. For many years, for 20 years, I think he was Qadi, he was the judge of the entirety of Misr at the time. So his grandchild Abu Bakr read Al-Adab al-Mufrad from him. His grandchild Abu Bakr, and Imam Badr al-Din ibn Jama'ah was someone who lived very long. If I'm not mistaken, he lived for about 70-60 years. Ibn Jama'ah. So his grandchild Abu Bakr read Al-Adab al-Mufrad from him. Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar rahimahullah read Al-Adab al-Mufrad from his grandchild. Ibn Hajar read from the grandchild of Ibn Jama'ah. And Badr al-Din ibn Jama'ah himself rahimahullah read Al-Adab al-Mufrad from the Imam Abu Tahir al-Silafi. Al-Imam Abu Tahir al-Silafi is Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn Silafa. Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn Silafa, the well-known scholar of Islam. Al-Imam Zahabi rahimahullah mentioned Abu Tahir al-Silafi to have lived for over 100 years. Some scholars say he lived for 120 years. He lived in Alexandria, in Alexandria, for 40 years after he toured around the cities of Islam. There was hardly a city of Islam where knowledge was glanced and spread, except that Abu Tahir al-Silafi went there to learn from the scholars of the city, not just that, and write down the books they had with them. So it was from Abu Tahir al-Silafi that Badruddin ibn Jama'ah read Al-Adab al-Mufrad. And Badruddin ibn Jama'ah, he said his grandchild Abu Bakr read it from him, and Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar read it from Abu Bakr, the grandchild of Badruddin ibn Jama'ah. And Al-Imam Abu Tahir al-Silafi read Al-Adab al-Mufrad from Al-Qadi Abu al-Ala al-Waqidi. You can see the isnad. This isnad was mentioned in Al-Jawahir wa Durar fi Tadzimati Shaykh al-Islam ibn Hajar by Al-Hafiz al-Sakhawi, called in two big volumes. He mentioned this isnad of Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar up to Al-Imam al-Bukhari. So Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar read Al-Adab al-Mufrad from Abu Bakr, the grandchild of Badruddin ibn Jama'ah, who read it from his grandfather, Badruddin ibn Jama'ah, who read it from Al-Imam Abu Tahir al-Silafi. Al-Imam Abu Tahir al-Silafi read Al-Adab al-Mufrad from Qadi Abu al-Ala al-Wafisi, and Qadi Abu al-Ala al-Wafisi wrote it and read from Abu Nasr ibn al-Niyaziki, and Abu Nasr ibn al-Niyaziki read Al-Adab al-Mufrad from Abu al-Khayf al-Bukhari, عن أبو الخير البخاري read الأدب المفرد from الإمام البخاري رحمه الله. This is the isnad of how الأدب المفرد itself, the book itself, has gotten to us. And then inside Al-Adab al-Mufrad, you'll be finding the Afsanid of Al-Imam al-Bukhari. The entirety of the Afsanid in Al-Adab al-Mufrad returns to Al-Bukhari, and it returns to the rest of the Ummah with this isnad that we have mentioned. I have just mentioned one of the two from the Afsanid that I have seen from manuscript, handwritten copies of Sahih al-Bukhari. One of them is this isnad of Al-Hafiz al-Hajar. The other one is the isnad from the people of India. It's held the oldest manuscript that occurs in the Indian subcontinent. Hence, brings the hadith from Al-Imam Qadi Abu'l-Ala, and it ends with one of the pickups of Al-Hafiz Ibn al-Jawzi and Al-Hafiz Ibn al-Fakir, whose name was Abu Hafs, Omar Ibn Hafs Ibn Ahmad al-Mukri. This is another isnad, but the one we have read to us is the isnad of Al-Hafiz Ibn Hajar. So we try to connect between 256 years after Hijra and about 700 to 800 years after Hijra. About 500 years of a gap, we find the book being read, being learned, being written down from one big scholar of Islam to the next big scholar of Islam. This is how the book itself, Al-Adab al-Mufrad, has reached us today. And there are Afsanid of Al-Adab al-Mufrad today. Between today, the scholars of today, and Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar, who is the 8th century of Islam. Many of their brothers who have these Afsanid. May Allah preserve all of us. So this is not that we have read. We will say Akhbarana Abu Nasr. This Akhbarana is a statement of who? Al-Imam Abu al-Ala al-Qadi al-Wafisi. So this, the entirety of this should come after Bismillah. And that is how it occurs in other copies of the book. The entirety of Akhbarana Abu Nafs Ahmad ibn Muhammad up to Haddathana Abu Abdullah al-Bukhari, the entirety of this should come immediately after Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Some of the scholars have mentioned it, and one of those who have mentioned something similar to that is Sheikh Qutbuddin. Fadlullah al-Jilani, the author of Fadlullah al-Samad, which is the oldest known sheikh of Al-Adab al-Mufrad. Fadlullah al-Jilani was one of the scholars. He was praised by the scholars of Islam. He is a sheikh of Sahih Bukhari, and he has mentioned that this isnad of Al-Adab al-Mufrad should come immediately after Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So that after Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, we are reading the statements of Al-Imam al-Bukhari. And the statements of Al-Imam al-Bukhari that starts the book Al-Adab al-Mufrad is Babu Qawli Allah Ta'ala wa wasfayna al-insana bi walidayhi husna. So the entirety of this isnad should come immediately after Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim up to Al-Imam al-Bukhari. It should come with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, so that after Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, we have this isnad that ends with Al-Imam al-Bukhari. And after that isnad that ends with Al-Imam al-Bukhari, we now have Babu Qawli Allah Ta'ala wa wasfayna al-insana biwalidayhi husna. We say that the ulama say this is the correct tafsir. But the prince, many of the prince have printed it with the isnad coming after the Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim and after Babu Qawli Allah Ta'ala, because what that would mean is that Babu Qawli Allah Ta'ala is not from the statement of Al-Imam al-Bukhari. So it should be the other way around. The isnad of Al-Adab al-Mufrad of Al-Imam al-Bukhari should come immediately after Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So that after Al-Imam al-Bukhari, the next thing we will find is Babu Qawli Ta'ala wa wasfayna al-insana biwalidayhi husna. This is for those who have those copies that I have mentioned. I have mentioned a number of copies. The copy of Dar al-Hadith, the copy of Dar al-Huda al-Muhammadi, the copy of Dar ibn Kathir, the copy of many other copies, even the copy of Qadlullah al-Samad and others. They have this that we have had to mention. So in that, those are copies. This is the explanation for what we have. What Al-Imam al-Bukhari himself, which forms the third issue for us today. What Imam al-Bukhari himself has started the book with is Babu Qawlihi Ta'ala. We would have understood from this second discussion that Al-Adab al-Mufrad has an isnad from Al-Imam al-Bukhari to the rest of the Ummah. Likewise, each of the hadith in Al-Adab al-Mufrad has an isnad from Al-Imam al-Bukhari to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you say a hadith that is coming from the Prophet, or from Al-Imam al-Bukhari to the companion, if you say a hadith that is coming from the companion, and from Al-Imam al-Bukhari to a tabi'in, if you say a hadith that is coming from any of the tabi'in, if you say a hadith marfu, if it's a hadith mawku, from hadith, from the maqtu'at, all of these, you will see that Al-Imam al-Bukhari has and it's not between him and the person who speaks on the marriage. So Al-Imam al-Bukhari has an isnad between himself and everything in Al-Adab al-Mufrad. Likewise, we have an isnad between Al-Imam al-Bukhari and the rest of the Ummah. This is what we have tried to clarify in the second point. The first point we made in the class today is that why do we start our books with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim? We mentioned the reasons for that. The Quran is said, start with Bismillah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would commence his writings to the people when he dictated and they were written down, it starts with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And we gave us a reference where we can find these letters. The work of Al-Imam Muhammad ibn Tulio. And the second thing we have discussed today, the third reason why we start our books with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim for us is that our scholars start their books. It surprises for a Talib al-Ilm when he was asked, why do you do this? This is what we have found our scholars doing from time to time. So this is the third reason for us. So the second issue we have discussed is the isnad of Al-Adab al-Mufrad from Al-Imam al-Bukhari to Hafiz al-Hajar between the 8th century of Islam and 256 after Al-Imam al-Bukhari. We try to create the link between these two. And then we try to make us understand some of the adjustments that need to be in some of the copies, printed copies of Al-Adab al-Mufrad that we have. So this is the second point we have today. The third point we have today is that Al-Imam al-Bukhari himself, rahimahullah, has started the book by saying, Babu qawlillahi ta'ala wa wassayna al-insana biwalidayhi husna. It says, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنْسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حُسْنًا وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنْسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حُسْنًا was used by Al-Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah as a chapter heading. And وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنْسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حُسْنًا is a verb in Surah Al-Ankabut. وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنْسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حُسْنًا occurs in Surah Al-Ankabut. In Surah Al-Ahqaf, we have something similar to that. وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنْسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ إِحْسَانًا. Ulama say, there are qira'at. The qira'a of وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنْسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حُسْنًا. This is what we read in Surah Al-Ankabut, in our popular qira'a. The qira'a of وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنْسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ إِحْسَانًا. But that's in Al-Ankabut. So what we read today, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنْسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حُسْنًا has another reading. وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنْسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ إِحْسَانًا. The second verse similar to it in Surah Al-Ahqaf, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنْسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ إِحْسَانًا. Ulama say has another reading. وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنْسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حُسْنًا. So وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنْسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ إِحْسَانًا can be read as وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنْسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حُسْنًا. And وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنْسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حُسْنًا can be read as وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنْسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ إِحْسَانًا. So these are the readings for these two similar verses in the Quran. So what does it mean? وَوَصَّيْنَا and we, Allah says in the Quran, وَوَصَّيْنَا and we have commanded. Allah says, وَصَّيْنَا, we have commanded. Allah mentions this command with ta'zim of the one giving command by way of mentioning his mightiness. We have mentioned, we have commanded. we have enjoined our final impact. We have commanded mankind. We have commanded mankind the walidayhi, as far as regarding his parents, regarding his two parents, his father and his mother, or her father and her mother, insan, human beings. Allah says, وَصْرَيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ. We have commanded mankind بِوَالِدَيْهِ حُسْنَى, that they must be kind, they must be nice, they must be compassionate regarding their parents. It's a command from Allah. وَوَصْرَيْنَا. Allah tells us out of His Majesty subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we have commanded al-insan, mankind, بِوَالِدَيْهِ, regarding his two parents, إِحْسَانًا, we have commanded that he is nice to them, he is compassionate with them, he is kind to them. Al-Imam Abdul Rahman As-Sa'di, in his book, As-Sa'di if you like, in his book, Tafsir al-Karim al-Rahman, he says, rahimahullah, that when Allah says, wa wasfayna, and we have commanded mankind, he said the meaning is, amarna al-insana bi birrihima. Amarna al-insana bi birrihima. We have commanded mankind with birr, to show kindness, dutifulness to his parents, to be dutiful to his parents. وَالْإِحْسَانِ إِلَيْهِمَا أَمَرْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِذِرِّهِمَا وَالْإِحْسَانِ إِلَيْهِمَا. We have commanded mankind to show dutifulness, to show kindness, وَالْإِحْسَانِ, and niceness, being good, إِلَيْهِمَا, to both of his parents or her parents, بِالْقَوْلِ وَالْعَمَلِ, in speech and in his actions. The command we have, brothers and sisters, from our Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala, is that we must be kind in our speech and in our actions to our parents. وَأَنْ يُحَافِظَ عَلَى ذَلِكَ. Al-Imam Musa'i rahimahullah says, وَأَنْ يُحَافِظَ عَلَى ذَلِكَ. That these verses means we should keep up upon that, upon what? بِذِرِّهِمَا وَالْإِحْسَانِ إِلَيْهِمَا. Being dutiful to them and being kind towards them, بِالْقَوْلِ وَالْعَمَلِ, in our speech and in our actions. وَأَنْ يُحَافِظَ عَلَى ذَلِكَ, and that we must stick to that. وَلَا يَعُقُّهُمَا. The child should not show عُقُوق, should not show undutifulness. وَيُسِيءُ وَيَسِيءُ إِلَيْهِمَا فِي قَوْلِهِ, and then become bad, show them badness, direct evil towards them, fi qawlihi wa amali, in his speech towards them and in his actions regarding them. Al-Imam Abdurrahman As-Sa'di rahimahullah, he says, wa wasfayna al-insana biwalidayhi husna, means that amarana al-insan, Allah is telling us that we have commanded mankind, bi birrihima, to be dutiful to them, both of his parents, وَالْإِحْسَانِ إِلَيْهِمَا, and to show kindness to both of his parents, بِالْقَوْلِ وَالْعَمَلِ, in our speech and in our actions. وَأَنْ يُحَافِظَ عَلَى ذَلِكَ, and then we must stick to doing that. وَلَا يَعُقُّهُمَا وَيَسِيءُ إِلَيْهِمْ. He will not show undutifulness to his parents. وَيَعُقُّهُمَا. He will not show on dutifulness to them, وَيَسِيءُ إِلَيْهِمَا, neither will he be evil or direct evil towards them, في قوله وعمله, in his speech or in his actions. This is what Allah tells us in this verse. And this explanation by this imam is also captured in another verse of the Quran. Because we will find that this verse is talking about the importance of being kind and dutiful to our parents. The first people must be kind, they must show the best of character to after the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after human being born, after the Messenger of Allah, they are our parents. So this verse makes us understand the importance of being kind and compassionate with our parents in the way we speak and in the way we act regarding our parents. When we act, we must show kindness. When we speak, we must show kindness. In fact, ulama say when he says bi walidayhi husna, he has not restricted the ihsan. It must be in every kind of goodness we know. Every kind of goodness we must show to our parents. In the way we speak with them and in the way we behave with respect to our parents. This meaning that Al-Imam Abdurrahman al-Sa'di has explained to us regarding this verse is also mentioned in another verse of the Quran. When Allah says, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ, and your Lord who created you, رَبُّكَ, O mankind, you, your Lord who created you, your Rabb, who made you, who sustains you, who provides you health, who has given you everything with which you look yourself, which may be a means of arrogance to you. Because today, many of us, because we think that we have obtained degrees, we speak English language, we now occupy offices, we have wealth, we have cars, we have children, we build big houses, we own entire cities and towns. These things may cause the individual to think that now they have the right to speak to his parents as he will. Let him not forget that the creator of the entire universe, Qadha Rabbuka, is the one who is giving him the command. Qadha Rabbuka, yani amara Rabbuka. Your Lord, just like what was praying, they have the same meaning and import. So our Lord who has created us, who provides us oxygen to breathe, who makes us sleep and wake up, to practice. Nobody has a power to make anybody sleep and wake up, except Allah to practice. This Allah, Father, he has enjoined mankind. Allah ta'budu ilayya. So nobody is worshipped except him to practice. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانٍ, and that the parents, our two parents, we must show kindness to them. So this shows the importance of showing kindness to our parents. Why? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has connected being kind to our parents. He has connected it to his worship. The right we have, Allah has over us, is that we worship him. He quickly mentions, along with that, the rights of our parents over us is what in walidaini ihsana. We must show ihsan. The ulama say the meaning of this ihsan was explained in this verse. And that was why Allah says, إِمَّا يَبْلُغَنَّ عِنْدَكَ الْكِبَرَ أَحَدُهُمَا أَوْ كِلَاهُمَا. إِمَّا يَبْلُغَنَّ عِنْدَكَ الْكِبَرَ. When your parents perhaps reach old age, and they are with you, أَحَدُهُمَا أَوْ كِلَاهُمَا, whether it is just your mother or just your father or both father and mother. I know very few of us would like to take our father and mother to ourselves. Very few. But it happens. And this is what should be the normal thing. The normal thing is that after a while, the child now brings the father and mother to himself, or to herself as the case is, or provides a means for them to be able to have company with him. Because at this age, the old age, the parents need the company of the children. There is nothing they need much more like the company of the child. Sometimes many of us, we fail in visiting our parents. We think that, oh, you instructed the bank to send 20,000 naira to her in the month, and that's all. It's not all. How about visiting them? How about talking to them? How about being nice to them? How about relating with them? How about providing them your ears for them to tell you what they have seen in life? All these are parts of being sure that we are nice to our parents. So Allah says, إِمَّا يَبْلُغَنَّ عِنْدَكَ الْكِبَرَ أَحَدُهُمَا أَوْ كِلَاهُمَا. When they become old and they are with you, whether one of them or the both of them, بَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍّ. Do not say to them, please excuse me. Do not make a statement of denigration towards them. وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا. Likewise, don't raise your voice harshly in one spot. So you see here, it is talking about a stand to parents with respect to our what? Our speech. A stand to parents with respect to our speech. And that no evil must come from us to our parents regarding our speech. You don't say to our parents, we do not say and must not say to our parents except what is good. فَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍ وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا. Don't say to them, excuse me, ma. Let me talk. Many brothers do that also. They say to their friends, hey, let me talk. Don't say that to yourself. وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا. Don't also make statements of belief to yourself. Allah says, وَكُلَّهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا. What you should say to them is no other than noble speech, honorable statements. Oh, mommy. Oh, daddy. Oh, and mommy. Oh, daddy. Humble and honorable statements are the only things that should come to you. So what was claiming in Sana Diwali Day, Husna has to do? Husna, goodness in terms of our speech. Only good speech should be directed to them. Evil speech should not be directed to our parents. This is the fourth point from the meaning of what was training in Sana Diwali Day, Husna. Husna regarding speech and action. For our speech, only good speech should be directed to them. No evil speech must be directed to our parents. This is the fourth point of benefit from an ihsan regarding our parents. The second area of an ihsan regarding our parents is regarding our action. That's why Allah says, وَحْفِظْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذُّلِّ مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ اِخْفِظْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذُّلِّ. The wings of your wings, your shoulders that you raise before your parents. Bring it down. Bring down the wings of humility. اِخْفِظْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذُّلِّ مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ. Not out of anger. Not out of, okay, I've heard, if they want to listen, okay, I've heard. Not like this. Out of rahmah, out of mercy and compassion. Bring down yourself. Humble yourself. It is now talking about a plan regarding our actions. وَصِدْ لَهُمَا, that you show kindness again in your actions. جَنَاحَ الذُّلِّ, the arms, your wings of humility, bring it down to yourself. Out of humility. وَقُلْ لَهُمَا مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ وَقُلْ رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا وَقُلْ رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا. From your actions also is that when they pass away, or even at old age they have not passed away, make sure you make dua. Pray for your parents. Pray for your parents. Oh Allah, grant them good sense if they have not passed away. And if they have passed away, oh Allah, forgive my parents. All of these areas and ways of praying defense, inshallah, will be mentioned by Imam al-Bukhari when we come fully into the book. So the point today, so that we can round off today, we already took the time, is that we discuss three main issues. The first is that why do our scholars comment their books with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim? The second is that the isnad of Imam al-Bukhari to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or to the companion, or to the tabi'i, or for in the book. But the isnad of al-Hafiz al-Hajar and others amongst the scholars, we have also discussed it at the beginning of the book, Al-Adabul. Some of us don't have that at all, especially those of us who have the translations that have been published of me. There is no issue of an isnad there. So it's not talking about us. It is talking about our brothers and sisters who have the copies of Al-Adabul Mufrad in Arabic and the Afghani have been mentioned. We mentioned to us where that isnad should be, as the scholars have said. And the first thing we try to discuss is the chapter heading itself. بَابُ قَوْلِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَىٰ وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ إِحْسَانًا. We have told us the readings of that part. وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ إِحْسَانًا can also be read as وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ إِحْسَانًا. And that the verse means that Allah commands us out of His majesty and power and authority that we must be kind and dutiful to our parents. Kindness and dutifulness to parents comes in two ways. It comes from our statements, it comes from our actions. Some rule of our statements is that only good statements should be directed to our parents. And we must not direct negative statements to them. Some rule of our actions is that only good actions should be directed to our parents. We must not direct negative actions towards our parents. This meaning of Fitna or Ihsana has been mentioned by Sheikh Abdul Rahman al-Sa'i, and it is supported by another verse of the Quran that tends to explain to us what this Ihsan means. I'd like to stop here, inshallah, for today. I hope that we can take one or two questions before the time comes to us. I think we have about 7 or 8 minutes. Inshallah, we can take 1, 2, 3 questions before we close today, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum.
We'll pray might Allah to continue to increase in beneficial knowledge and make you from amongst those with which Islam will get to greater height. We are having some questions here, inshallah. And the first question is that does the book Al-Adabul Mufrad have a Muqaddimah?
It does not have a Muqaddimah. The copies that we have seen both in the manuscript and in print do not have Muqaddimah. They have occurred as many others amongst the books of Al-Imam al-Bukhari has occurred. We will always only have Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, and he goes on to say what he has intended in the book. The same way it has done in Sahih al-Bukhari, he will say Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Kitabu Badil Wahi. He went on to say, and in the rest of his book too. So we have not seen a Muqaddimah like we would find in Sahih Muslim, where Al-Imam Muslim Rahimahullah started his book with a Muqaddimah, and others amongst the scholars of Islam. This book, Al-Adab al-Mufrad, no Muqaddimah is mentioned regarding it, Allahu A'lam.
Jazakumullah khairan.
Ameen.
The next question is that, what are the remedies to the one who forgets things very easily? Perhaps the Quran and Azkar. The person has always tried, but the person finds it very, very hard to not forget whatever he or she has memorized.
One of the things the scholars have mentioned about the issues of memory is that they mention repetition. If you memorize something and you want to keep it in mind, repeat it at all times. After a while, it becomes a part of you. For example, our names. We mention our names repeatedly and it becomes a part of us. We don't think to say our names. Look at Surah Al-Fatiha. We repeat Surah Al-Fatiha so often that I don't think any one of us can remember the day he sat down to memorize Surah Al-Fatiha. And we have memorized it. But the memorization came out of repetition. So one of the ways to sustain something in the mind is to regularly repeat it. Regularly repeat it. Ulama say this a lot. And that's why they encourage us, even those of our brothers who have read the entire Al-Bukhari, and have studied it, the scholars will always say, don't forget to always read the book on and on, on and on, on and on. And it will remain in your mind, inshallah. Al-Imam Ibn al-Mubarak was once asked, how are you people able to memorize the names of 30,000, 40,000, 3,000 hadith? How are you able to keep all this huge information in your mind? It says, شَيْءٌ اِشْتَقْنَا إِلَيْهَا فَتَعَلَّقَ بِأَلْحَانِنَا. There are things that we love to keep these things in our mind. فَتَعَلَّقَ, it became stuck in, it itself got stuck in our mind. So when you repeat it, it will get stuck in your mind. So Azkar, the Quran, repeat the Quran always. Repeat your daily Azkar always, even at the time that it is not the time for Azkar. By way of making the murada of those Azkar, not by way of actually making those Azkar at the time. You make those Azkar at your time, and you try to repeat it at other times too, by way of making sure that you don't forget those Azkar. And there is no statement of goodness that one utters. It will be documented for you out of the goodness that you make. This is the way people even with the Quran, even with books, you have scholars who will tell you he can't even remember how many times he read the Quran. One of the early Muslims was passing away, and his daughter was feeling so bad. This occurred in the issues, the narrations that have been reported about the Quran. The daughter was afraid. She said, "Why are you afraid?" The father was asking the daughter, "Why are you afraid?" "Say, I'm afraid because you are passing." He said, "Don't be afraid. In this house alone, I have read the Quran more than 3,000 times. So don't be afraid. If you read the Quran repeatedly, it becomes talking. God's talk gets talking to your life. In fact, even without an intention to memorize, when you read something, you read, when the tilawa of an individual is very, very regular, he'll be handling and relating with the Quran like a person who has memorized the entirety of the Quran. So a medicine for a weak memory is repetition. You can repeat all the time and get your mind attached to it. Bismillah, and then you pray that Allah keeps these things in your mind. There are companions who beg Allah, pray that Allah should give them repentive memory. Amongst them was Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu. The Prophet also prayed for the second means of having a repentive memory is to beg Allah to keep your mind a mind that retains information. Imam al-Zuhri has recommended perhaps licking honey, because when he was asked, how do you come about retentive memory? He mentioned licking honey. But the first two are the main issues that we can advise our brothers on, inshallah.
JazakAllah khairan. This question I is asking that, how do we relate with those of our parents who were nonchalant regarding our care? Perhaps a parent that after that abandoned the child for a motherless home or whatever, and the child grew up to be someone in life. What should be the child's disposition as regards taking care of such parents?
These are some of the chapter headings that have been mentioned by Al-Imam al-Bukhari under our relationship with our parents in this book, Al-Adabul Mufrad. So in a bigger manner, inshallah, we are still going to come back to this discussion about how we relate to parents who were, so to speak, who were hurtful, who were harmful, who were difficult with their children, who didn't want, who used to punish their children and all of these. But a summary answer we can have about that is that you cannot pay back the goodness of pregnancy and delivery. Pregnancy and delivery, so you can't pay it back. Allah says, Hamalatu ummuhu kurha. Yani, Allah mashaka. Wa wadaatuhu kurha. The day that she gave birth to you, she wouldn't know whether she was in the heavens or on the earth. You can't pay back this one. There are afar who come back to all of this, inshallah, in Al-Adabul Mufrad. So whether those parents were good to us or not, as far as they are our parents, no matter what you become today, you still owe them the duty of being nice to your parents. This is from one angle. The second angle is that you pay back if you still think that they've been not nice to you. Do you pay back evil with goodness, or you pay back goodness? You pay back evil with evil. So the basic rule in Islam is to say goodness, and it's the most encouraging thing, more so when it has to do with our parents, those who have the greatest right to love. Even if you feel that there is an evil condemned towards you, you still have a duty to pay back goodness with that evil, even though that evil is just from your thinking. The fact that they gave back to you is enough good that they have done to you that you cannot pay back. May Allah forgive all of us and make our parents righteous people, make us two righteous children. One of our scholars recently, he wrote that there are parents, there are children who now deny the goodness that their parents have done to them. He said he gives them glad tidings that they should just wait for the time their own children too will come back to say, oh, you are useless parents too. They are children who say that their parents were useless. Say, don't worry. Your children are coming back to tell you too that you are an irresponsible and useless father. So no matter the case, the fact that they gave birth to us is enough goodness. We can't pay back the hardship of pregnancy. We can't pay back the hardship of delivery. I have seen women, I go with women into labor rooms when they deliver. I can feel it. I don't run away like many others. May Allah forgive all of us. You see how a child comes back from a woman. You know that being a parent is not an easy task. This duty of having delivered of itself, you can't take it back. So no matter what you think, oh, they did was bad, you can't pay back. So start paying back. Start trying to pay back the goodness for delivery, the goodness for pregnancy, the goodness for breastfeeding. They didn't receive any money from you. And how much could you have paid for their breastfeeding? Whether a woman is hungry or not, she breastfed her child. No matter the situation. And Imam Bukhari in his book, Al-Adabul Mufrad, he has a chapter in it. He said, Al-Ummahat Rahimah. Al-Ummahat Mufrad. Al-Ummahat Limadah Rahimah. They are the most compassionate of the people. This compassion inside them for you, you can't pay them back. No matter what the mistake they would have done in your dealing with you as you grew up. So no matter our status and condition, we must show goodness to our parents. May Allah forgive our parents whatever errors they did. This is what we say, وَقُلْ رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَا لِصَغِيرًا. May Allah forgive them. May Allah make it easy for them. Those of them who have passed away, may Allah forgive them their shortcomings. The goodness that they should for us, may Allah multiply the goodness. I think we will be sufficient to talk here, brothers. Adi?
عليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك، أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت، أستغفرك.
أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت.